Thank you, and thank you for your patience. Okay, Shavua Tov, everyone. It is so wonderful to see Esther, Shalom, and Sarah, and Lee, and Becky, and Etty, and Shelly, who's here also, and Rosalind, and Merla, and Bella, Betocha Otoshala, Ezeyofi. Okay, what we're going to do, I think again, I want to apologize. I just had some connectivity issues, but I think I also, again, I'm having a difficult time this morning getting started because I know, again, on Friday, the message went out that this is our last shiur for the year. So this is always very difficult to say goodbye, even for a short amount of time, because Bezrat Hashem, we're going to restart next year. I'm actually going to send out different suggested topics for everyone to vote on and to choose, Bezrat Hashem. So without further ado, what we're going to end our shiur with this week's parsha, with Parshat Shlach, definitely a turning point in Sefer Bamidbar with regard not only to obviously the punishment of Am Yisrael for 40 years in the Midbar, but really a turning point in the entire structure of Sefer Bamidbar by virtue of the fact that we just ended Parshat Bahalotcha with the ideal nisiyot, with ideal journey to Eretz Yisrael. We're going to hear in Sefer Dvarim Perek Aleph that we were only 11 days away from Eretz Yisrael when these journeys began. So if we were supposed to start on Chaf Iyar, then, in fact, again, 11 days thereafter, Rosh Chodesh Sivan, we were supposed to arrive in Eretz Yisrael. We already saw, if you remember, in Parshat Bahalotcha, there was a little bit of a delay of Tavira, and then a 30-day delay because of Kivrot HaTa'afa, and another 7 days waiting for Miriam to heal from Tzaraat. And we've spoken a lot about Miriam and the leadership, and we see that really what happened starting Parshat Shlach is we have all these narratives that talk about tensions of leadership. These are really the common denominator between all these stories, even the ones that began in Parshat Bahalotcha, are tensions between Moshe's political, and as we know from the story, not only of Meraglim, but Miriam and Korach, the story of Moshe Rabbeinu's political and religious leadership, again, and the tension with Am Yisrael. And so what we're going to explore in this week's Parsha is something truly phenomenal, namely the beginnings already of the, I'm going to call it distribution of power or the succession of power. Already we see at the climax, again, or one can even say the nadir, right? The bottom point of all these tensions that are going to be expressed in the story of the Meraglim are already the beginnings of different forms of leadership that are going to take over. So that's why what we're going to be exploring together is really the leadership of Kalev ben Yefune and Yehoshua ben Nun. And thinking a lot about this, again, in terms of, okay, so who are the Talmudic personalities that match them? The truth is that in every generation, we already see, again, and I would say today, and I mean literally today, is a great day to speak about it, meaning the transference of power from a very strong leader to the successors, meaning who are going to be the successors, Lahavdil, really, Mei Alafim to Bibi Netanyahu. Is it going to be a Gideon Sa'ar personality or a Naftali Bennett personality? Is it going to be a Yair Lapid personality or, I don't know, you know, maybe an Avigdor Lieberman type of personality? So Etty is shaking her head. Again, emphatically, no. Again, but Lahavdil, what we see is that in every generation and in Talmudic times as well, what we find is the transition term is going to be the most difficult, right? The transition from one generation of Tanaim to the next, whether it be from the Zugot, Gena, to the time period of Rambam Gamliel. And we see that there is a constant shift between having dual paradigms of leadership to one paradigm of leadership. Now, what's interesting is that we also see this idea perpetuating throughout Jewish history, not only in Talmudic times, even within Tanakh. We have after Yehoshua, right, who basically is in the end going to be the one, and we're going to discuss today why, to succeed Moshe Rabbeinu. We then have the distribution of power, even though it's clear that Yehoshua wants there to be really a trajectory towards kingship. In the end, it leads to a state of chaos, anarchy, parochial judges during the time of the Shoftim, finally joining together through Shmuel HaNavi to have Malchut, the Malchut of Beit Shaul, followed, as we know, by the Malchut of Beit David. And then that doesn't even last that long. After that, then we have divided Malchut, but still a certain ideal when you have a centralized form of government. So the question is, when we look at these personalities and what we're going to do today, and really I'm going to ask everyone to open up their Chumash, because today we're going to be involved in a dynamic study of trying to appreciate, we're going to be jumping around a little, but trying to appreciate different models of leadership throughout the generations by seeing the first really of successors, a very strong Malchut manifest through Kalev and Yehoshua. So we're going to try to understand the differences between their personalities, why ultimately the personality of Yehoshua, at least for this time period, is the one that's going to be selected. And maybe when we pay a little more attention to the story itself in Parshat Shlach, maybe we're going to be able, Be'ezrat Hashem, to appreciate some of the differences in different contexts. And therefore, what we're going to, again, explore together now is really an understanding of this when we look at Kalev and Yehoshua in the story of the Meraglim. So let's take a look. Again, we're in Perek Yud Gimel. Let's even, again, due to the fact that we're going to try to see as much and as many of these stories and how they continue and develop throughout Tanakh, we're going to begin actually after the Meraglim come back. So we're in Perek Yud Gimel. Pasuk Chavchet, right? The initial response. Again, after the Meraglim returned from their 40 days in Canaan, they describe it to Am Yisrael. And this, by the way, is part of the problem because Hashem began the parsha with Shlach Lecha Anashim. Moshe is the CEO. They should be saying Moshe Rabbeinu as the initiator. And instead, what happens is that the people, as we know, end up returning not just to Moshe, but they end up returning to the entire nation. They see themselves as representing the nation. And at the conclusion of their description of a beautiful land, again, of the land, they show them the Eshkol HaNavim, and again, they come back. And now they hint, basically, that's how it begins. They hint to Am Yisrael that they have no hope of achieving any victory. So again, and again, what are the words that they say? Efes, the famous words, the Ramban Nachmanides says this is where their sid begins. Ki az ha'am ha'yoshev ba'aretz v'harim b'tzurot gedolot ma'od. וגם ילידי הענק ראינו שם. המלאק יושב בארץ הנגב, והחיטי והיבוסי והמורי יושב בהר, והכנני יושב על הים ועל יד הירדן. And they say basically that no matter what, again, the people that live in the land, they're very strong. The cities are fortified. They're great. Again, we also saw that there were children of giants that are there and they live all over the place, basically. They go throughout the land. And by mentioning even the Amalekites who live in the southern areas of Eretz Yisrael, obviously, they still have trauma from just a year earlier when they were attacked by Amalek. Immediately thereafter, we're up to Pasuk Lamed, we hear about Kalev's reaction. Vayas Kalev etam. Kalev is the one to silence the people. And it doesn't just say that. Vayas Kalev etam el Moshe. He's trying to silence them towards Moshe. He's waiting. He realizes, okay, the people are screaming. Again, there's havoc now that has erupted within the camp of Am Yisrael. Nonetheless, he feels, okay, Moshe Rabbeinu, you know, he's a leader. He should do something. So Kalev silences everyone, which already shows us a certain domineering personality. Vayomer, alo na'ale, v'yarashnu otaki achol nuchala. Kalev silences them and he says, again, no, we're going to go up. We're going to inherit the land. Again, we're able to prevail. This is, again, Kalev's basic, I'm going to say even, not only war cry. Again, this is going to be Kalev's personality throughout. Now, it should be noted that the only person here who stands up against the rest of the spies right now is, in fact, Kalev. Notice that there's no other reaction, no reaction of Moshe Rabbeinu, no reaction at this point of Yehoshua either. Again, no reaction of Aaron, right? Giving us a sense that is, I already mentioned, there definitely is a lot of noise going on right now. Maybe Moshe is trying to say something, but again, we're not going to say it. And I've heard some people say, well, maybe Yehoshua is really on the side of the Meraglim. But no, we're going to see that it's because right now Yehoshua is waiting, like everyone else is, for a certain response of Moshe Rabbeinu. So now let's continue.
It could be also that Kalev, when he's saying what he says, okay, he's being positive on the one hand, alona alek hinuchal. He doesn't say ki hashem itanu. הוא לא אומר מאיפה בא הכוח שלהם.
Mitsuyan, Mitsuyan. Sarah, we're going to speak a lot about this. Beautiful. And please remember that this is presented as a spontaneous response, right? He's trying to get their directions towards Moshe by basically saying, no, 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 this definitely is not Moshe's message. But you're right, he doesn't really elaborate. He doesn't say, ki achon nuchala, again, we're going to be able to overcome, but he doesn't actually say how, when, where, why. Now, notice that as a result, again, the Meraglim, meaning, you know, Kalev here isn't successful. He isn't successful in getting them to listen to Moshe, and he doesn't continue. Instead, the Meraglim, look at Pasuk Lamed Aleph right afterwards. Again, the Meraglim continue to incite the people. They're now going to speak very badly about the land. They're going to succeed in persuading Am Yisrael. Let's look. Vanashim Asher Alu Imo. Now the focus is on Kalev and the Anashim Asher Alu Imo and his colleagues over here who were with him. Amru Lo Nochala Lo Talam. And they're incorporating, as Sarah said, the exact same terminology. No, we disagree. Not alo nale, and not yachol nuchal. No, lo nuchal la'alot. We can't do this. Ki chazako mimenu. Because they are greater, they are stronger than we. This is when, according to most Parshanim, Rashi, for example, this is when their sin begins. This is when they start to actually speak badly about Eretz Yisrael. It's a land that consumes its inhabitants. And everyone who lives there. Are strong people. Now, this could also be understood as something positive. You know, it's a land that breeds strong people. Again, it, you know, they eat Wheaties for breakfast, but that's not what they say, right? They turn this around as, oh, we're not going to be able to survive here. And the psychological approach here, we saw ourselves as grasshoppers, and then therefore we projected this upon everyone around us. And of course, and we were grasshoppers in everyone else's eyes. And why is this, according to most Parshanim, the actual beginning of the sin? Because only now, let's take a look at the beginning of Parak Yudalid, are we going to see the reaction of Am Yisrael. Batisa kol haida, vayitznu at kolam veivku ha'am balayla hu, vayilonu ha'moshe v'yal Aaron. Kol menei Yisrael. We still haven't heard from Moshe and Aaron. In the meantime, everyone is complaining. Vayimru alehem kol haida, lu matnu be'eretz Mitzrayim, omed b'midbar hazeh lu matnu. We can't believe it. Right now, they're saying it would have been better for us to just die in the wilderness. Why is Hashem bringing us into this land? Lama Hashem hibi otanu al aretz hazot lempol b'cherev nashenu b'tapenu yu levaz. Halo tov lanu shuv Mitzrayim. Not only do they say one to the other, let us go and return to Mitzrayim, rather Vayomru Eish Elachav Nitzna Rosh Venashuva Mitzrayim. What's Nitzna Rosh? What is this terminology even that they're saying literally one person to the other? Nitzna Rosh, let us appoint a leader, right? Basically, they're saying we need a new leader. So notice that when we look at this complaint of Am Yisrael, when we take a look at the sin, we see that there are really two different elements. The first one is, again, at the beginning of Perek Yudalid, Vatisa koleida, vayitnu at kolam beyivku, vayilonu Am Moshe, right? The idea of them complaining. And the initial complaint is only about the fact that they can't enter Eretz Yisrael, right? It seems to be a complaint about, again, about the land, right? That's number one, which means that they're nervous really about losing their wars of conquest. But the second component is that what's even worse, when they say one to the other, here's the second element. Let's appoint a Rosh, a chief, to return to Mitzrayim. Right here we see that the people actually plan on returning to Mitzrayim. And that's why we need new leadership, because Moshe's leadership took us out of Mitzrayim. We don't want to go out. We want to go back in. So since they know Moshe and Aaron are definitely not going to reverse that, they're not going to cooperate with the plan. So we need a new leader. That's when Moshe and Aaron react. Let's take a look. We're up to Pasuk Hey. Exactly then when they hear about a Rosh, vayipol Moshe v'Aaron al pneihem. And Ibn Ezra points out over here, Moshe and Aaron falling on their faces, this is a sign of choser onim. They don't even know what to do now. Again, they realize that the people don't relate to them at all. They fall if nekol kala da b'nei Yisrael. Unlike Parshat Kitisa, when they fell in Sefer Shmot just a few months earlier. They fell at the time of, or a year earlier, at the time of Chet HaEgel. Again, Moshe fell out of prayer, out of supplication. Now he's falling out of a sense of really a failure in front of the people. It's only when the complaint and the reason why only now do they fall on their faces is because now when the complaint becomes a rebellion against leadership, then it makes sense that now Moshe and Aaron are going to respond in a very drastic manner. And even at this stage, one would say that, I don't know, the response is not necessarily what we would expect from the leaders of the nation, because instead of acting firmly, instead of acting decisively, they're expressing a sense of shock. They're expressing a sense of, as we mentioned, a failure by falling upon their faces before Am Yisrael. Moshe doesn't act even with the firmness of Parsha Pahalotcha, even with, I would say, definitely his reaction of a previous episodes. Again, nor does he start davening for them. So the falling is not falling before HaKadosh Baruch Hu, says Ibn Ezra, b'tfilah, again, b'nefilat apayim, in supplication, but rather, again, more as really a tachanunim in front of the people, right, pleading before them. Almost as if he basically is saying, come on, like, really, don't do this. And what's so interesting is that this, we're not really, it's not clear, again, what type of a feeling over here. Again, now later, Moshe Rabbeinu is going to talk about the story and he's going to talk more about what he said, but not necessarily this reaction of falling in front of them. But really, it seems as if he's trying, again, to stop their rebellion. Now, and only now, again, as this crisis reaches its climax, right, with both of the problems over here, take a look at the very next pasuk. Now, from Pasuk Bav through Pasuk Yud, we're going to see that Yehoshua is going to now say something. Take a look at this. After, Vayipol Moshe v'Aaron al pneim lifnei kol kala da pnei Yisrael, v'Yehoshua ben Nun, he's mentioned first, v'Kali ben Yefuneh min hatarim et ha'aretz karu bigdehem. Now, Yehoshua and Kalev tear their garments. And we're going to speak more about this. Vayomru el kol ha'da pnei Yisrael lemor. Now, at least Kalev isn't alone. Now, they're going to say something, not towards Moshe, not to get Moshe to say something. Rather, they're going to join together, a common voice, two leaders, instead of Moshe and Aaron. And that's exactly how the Torah presents it. They're basically almost the substitutes for Moshe and Aaron right now. We're going to see who's the substitute for Moshe, who's the substitute for Aaron. Stay tuned. But let's look here. Again, and this is so phenomenal because up until now, each one of our shiurim was about how these models of leadership are perpetuated over the course of thousands of years. Here we have, even within one scene, the Torah telling us, okay, see how leadership, Moshe and Aaron's leadership, is continuing through Yehoshua and Kalev's. And now with their common voice, they turn to the people. Vayamru al kol adap b'nei Yisrael lemor, ha'aretz asher avarnu ba latorot ha'tova, ha'aretz ma'od ma'od, im chafetz banu Hashem, b'vio tanu ala aretz hazot, v'nat unit תנה לנו ארץ אשר היא זבת חלב ודבש, אך בהשם אל תמרדו, ואתם אל תראו את עם הארץ, כי לחמנו הם, סרצי להם עליהם, והשם איתנו אל תיראום. ויאמרו כל העדה לרגום אותם באבנים. So we're going to see, again, the congregation said, stone them. What's the pshat? Stone Yehoshua and Kalev. Or maybe stone Moshe and Aaron. It basically is the same over here. So what did Yehoshua and Kalev say? After they tear their garments, they basically say to B'nai Yisrael, no, we saw the same land as the rest of the Meraglim, and it actually is Tova Ma'od Ma'od. So not only that, if Hashem wants, he can bring us into the land, give it to us, because remember, it is an Eretz of Hatchalav Udvash. And again, do not rebel, because you shouldn't have any fear of the people of the land, because Hashem is no longer allowing them to stay, which means that Sartzilam, their guard, literally, again, is going. Their guard, pardon this, but their guard is gone. So here, Kalev and Yehoshua are presenting a very united front. Again, they're basically trying to counter the claim of the Meraglim and this whole rebellion, with a Yehoshua appearing first this time, even before Kalev. So notice the very passionate defense. They're defending not Moshe and Aaron, they're defending the land. They're defending faith in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. They have the right and the ability, by the way, they say, to argue for the land, because they actually went with the other spies to spy out the land. So they were also told to bring back an evaluation. as opposed to Moshe and Aaron, they don't really take part in this argument because they haven't even seen this land yet. So Caleb and Yehoshua, if you think about it, they actually display very, very impressive leadership, and not just leadership, but courage. And it couldn't have been easy for them to stand up against the rest of the spies. And at this point already, the entire nation is in a state of crisis. So they're all screaming and crying. So they're standing up in front of everyone. And we see by the end of the parsha that the pshat, according to most parshanim, is that the entire Eidah wants to stone them, Caleb and Yehoshua. So imagine this, you know, literally they're presenting themselves in front of a lynch mob, right? Which unfortunately we can actually picture today. So notice that this situation.
Shani, yeah, they also still have horror in the back of their minds of what happened to him.
You sound like I did.
I have pneumonia.
You have pneumonia. Make sure to take care of yourself. Ay, ay, ay. Ay, Becky, that's not good. Okay, so Becky's 100% right that they are. Again, they have what to fear, right? The Midrash says that, yeah, they didn't like the leadership of Hur, again, who was trying to defend Moshe. So they killed Hur. And that's why Aaron had to step in and placate the people. Here, Caleb and Yehoshua aren't going to placate the people. They're willing to risk their lives and in defense of Eretz Yisrael. Now, notice that only now Yehoshua steps in, which only emphasizes his absence at the very beginning. Why didn't Caleb say anything at the very beginning, right? When there were first hints, again, to problems. So we said that maybe the whole idea is that when everyone is first coming back, again, Moshe and Aaron can't say anything because they didn't actually see the land, right? And therefore, again, now we understand a little more that, again, as long as the argument concerned the nature of the land and the chances of success in conquering the land, then they believe that the nation would listen only to someone who actually been to the land. So Caleb is really the one to say, I'm there, alone, don't worry. Again, in addition, they also, again, the Meraglim could have also hoped that, you know what, that they're going to rile the people up. And Caleb and Yehoshua, or maybe Yehoshua in particular, felt that this was just an initial reaction and this pessimism and this zeitgeist of complaint is going to pass only when Yehoshua sees that, oh my gosh, they're crying. They're really caught up in all this crisis. Then he starts to say something. But again, why? We're going to try to explain why does he remain silent at the beginning. So let's take a look. And we're going to, for now, leave this unresolved. But instead, we're going to turn to Yehoshua and Caleb, not only here, but the way that they continue throughout the story. So we know that when it comes to the punishment that comes thereafter, Yehoshua and Caleb are going to be singled out, as you remember. Again, let's take a look at Perek Yudalid, Pasuk Yud Aleph. Here we see that the punishment appears in two parallel, but not necessarily identical parshiot, right? The first parshia, Perek Yudalid, Pasuk Yud Aleph through Pasuk Chafei. You can look at this very quickly. Again, Hashem speaks to Moshe, tells him that he wants to kill Am Yisrael again, but because, again, of Moshe davening to him, again, this is all, again, from Pasuk Yud Aleph through Pasuk Chafei, Moshe says, oh no, what about Chilul Hashem, Vishamu Mitzrayim, and what about the fact that you have a promise that you have to bring us of the land of Eretz Yisrael? So because of Moshe's tefillah, which we know is really built off of Chet HaEgel, again, HaKadosh Baruch Hu lessens the punishment. But then, even if there is an alleviation of the punishment, we find that in the second parshia. So now we're in Perek Yedalid, starting from Pasuk Chavav, right after Hashem says, okay, fine. Again, I'm going to bring Am Yisrael into the land, but not them. Right? Hashem says, Salachti kidvarecha. Let's even just continue from Pasuk Chafbet Ruchafei. Ki kol hanashim haro'im et kvodi v'totatai asher tziti b'mitzrayim u'b'midbar v'inesu'oti z'ezer pamim v'lo shamu b'koli. But how about these people that have witnessed everything that I did and nonetheless are not listening to me? Im yiru'at ha'art asher nishbati levotam v'chom anatzai lo yiru'ah. This generation is not going to see the land. I'll bring the next generation in, but not this one. But who are the two exceptions? Vavdi Caleb. Hashem only mentions here Caleb. Kalev, Ekev Haita Ruach Acheretimo. Please remember that terminology. Kalev, who has a different spirit with him. Again, he is going to Vayimalei Acharei Vaviyotival Arta Sherbashama Bazaro Yerishana. Again, he will marry to go into the land. So Kalev is the exception. And then starting Pasuk Chafav, in the second part of the Parshia, this is where we're going to hear that, again, the punishment is given right away. Again, it's going to be mida keneged mida, yom lishana, a day for every, or a year for every day. Again, and Bnei Yisrael are going to wander in the Midbar for 40 years. Here we also see that it's not just a punishment for the generation, but for the miraglim in particular. Again, look at Pasuk Lamed Daled, b'mispar ha'yimim asher tartem et ha'aretz, 40 yom, yom lishana, tesu at avonotechem, 40 shana, v'yedatem et tnuati, ani ha'shem dibarti, yom lo zot, eseh l'chol ha'idah ra'ah zot, hanu'adim alai b'midbar hazeh, yitamu b'sham yamutu, a nice play on words, v'anashim asher shalach Moshe l'tor et ha'aretz, v'yishuvu v'yilenu alav et kol ha'idah, lo ti dibar la'aretz, v'yamutu anashim l'ti dibarta ha'aretz. For Abba Magifa Lepnei Hashem. And then only Pasuk Lamed Chet brings in Yoshua ben Nun with Kalev ben Yefune, exactly in the same order that we found Yoshua and Kalev mention. Chayu min hanashim ha'hem holchim la'Torah Taretz. They're the only two who survived amongst the Meraglim. So this is so interesting because, in addition to speaking about the differences between the cycles, again, the status of Kalev and Yehoshua changes within these parshiot. Again, in the first parshia, we hear only about Kalev, who has this ruach acheret imo. Again, he has a different spirit. He followed me fully, and therefore I'm going to bring him into the land, again, and not just into the land, v'aviyotiv el ha'aret asher bashama. Again, I'm going to bring him into the land where he went. Chazal say, based on this, again, and later on in Sefer Yehoshua, that he's speaking about Chevron in particular, where only Kalev went in. But whatever the case may be, Kalev is mentioned. He's going to be brought into the land, as opposed to the entire generation that left Mitzrayim. Notice that Kalev alone is mentioned here as being one who is spared the punishment of not entering Eretz Yisrael. He alone is promised that he is going to inherit the land. Where the story to end here, we're going to see that, you see that, again, Yehoshua, I guess, fell short of HaKadosh Baruch Hu's expectations. He was silent during this whole time, so only Kalev is singled out. But no, let's continue. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu talks about how the punishment of wandering in the Midbar for 40 years is going to start right now, then there is a change. Then there's a relation to Yehoshua, and not just to Kalev. Then when Hashem speaks about, again, all those who are going to die out, except for Kalev ben Yefune and Yehoshua ben Nun. And then the very end, Yehoshua ben Nun and Kalev ben Yefune, again, they live as opposed to the rest of the Meraglim who die. So what we see is that, okay, in the second Parshia, Yehoshua and Kalev are inseparable, right? They're mentioned together. Both, not just Kalev, both Yehoshua and Kalev are removed here from the status quo, from the decree of not entering the land. Both together are also saved from this terrible plague that killed the other spies. So it seems that Yehoshua, again, Yehoshua, I guess his second appearance, right? Yehoshua's stand, whatever Yehoshua said, even though it was at a later stage of the rebellion, that was still enough to save him. So still we're wondering, what's the difference between them, right? Why does Hashem, if Hashem knows that he's going to also say that Yehoshua is saved, why does Hashem first mention only that Kalev is going to be saved? So before we also address this, we're going to look at two more references to the story. To the story of Yehoshua and Kalev, right? So again, let's continue when Moshe Rabbeinu again is going to recount the story, as we know, in Sefer Devarim. So this is what I meant by we're doing a little flipping, again, in the Tanakh this time, in the Torah, again, and definitely in the between the Chumashim. So let's open up to Devarim Perek Aleph, right? This is fast forward 40 years, Moshe Rabbeinu's last mitzvah speech. Let's see how he begins. We're in Perek Aleph. Let's take a look at Pasuk Lamed Daled. So I'm turning to this together with you, Pasuk Lamed Daled. Vayishma Hashem, he's referring to, again, the fact that Hashem was always in front of them. And then, again, they complained about coming into the land. Pasuka, lamedalid, vayishma Hashem et kol debrechem, vayikso, vayishava lemor. When Hashem heard you complain about the land, he said, im yira ish ban Hashem ha'ila, hador haraze, et ha'aret ha'tova asher nishbati, latit lavotechem. I swear that I will not give you the land that I promised to your forefathers, zulati, kaleb, and yifune, hu yirenu. Again, Kalev mentioned separately, except for Kalev, he will see it. And I'm going to give him the land that he himself literally stepped foot on. Again, that's a reference to Hebron. Hashem was also angry with me. Hashem even told me, says Moshe, that I couldn't go. Yoshua ben Nun, how made lafanacha, hu yavo shama. But Yoshua, who's standing in front of you, he will go. Oto chazek, ki hu yanchilenu et Yisrael. And you have to give him extra strength because he's going to be the one to settle on Yisrael, but everyone else is going to die. So notice again that again, Hashem says, Kale, or Moshe says, everyone died. Again, those that did not listen to Hashem, except for Kaleb ben Yefuneh, who was promised that he will see the land and that he will be given land upon which he has trodden, and this will belong to his descendants because he followed Hashem. And Yoshua ben Nun, who stands before you, he will go in. Again, and therefore, Moshe, you have to encourage him because he's going to be the one to actually inherit the land. So notice that here again, there's a very clear distinction between Kalev ben Yefuneh and Yoshua ben Nun. Kalev, again, alone is not included in the decree of the entire generation. Only he's promised the inheritance of the land. Very much always this order. Kalev mentioned separately first, and Yoshua is mentioned not as someone who's exempt from punishment for the sin of the spies, but rather someone who's been spared punishment because he's standing in front of Moshe, because he is Moshe's replacement. But this is very difficult if you think about it, because if Yoshua did play some role in, you know, in what the Meraglim did, then what punishment, right? Then we wouldn't expect him to be the successor of Moshe Rabbeinu. On the other hand, if Yoshua didn't sin, then why doesn't the Torah state it more explicitly? And our Parsha says even that Yoshua stood by Kalev's side, at least even for the second stage of the rebellion. So why doesn't Moshe talk about that? Why doesn't Moshe speak about the fact that Yoshua also resisted the Meraglim? And not only that, but we're going to see if we turn to Yoshua Perek Yudalid, the omission of Yehoshua's part in opposing the Meraglim is even described when Kalev speaks to Yoshua in Sefer Yoshua. So let's turn. Don't worry, I think this is going to be the last time that I ask you to flip around. But let's open up to Yoshua Perek Yudalid. And this is really fascinating. In Yoshua Perek Yudalid, when we hear about the initial goralot, the different divisions of the land that are going to be inherited, Kalev stands up in Perek Yudalid Pasuk Vav, and he says, "Vayikshu b'nei Yuda al Yoshua b'Gilgal, v'yomrei lav Kalev ben Yefuneh Haknezi, ata yadat et hadavar shedibreshem al Moshe, ish elokim al odotai v'al odotecha b'kadesh barnea." Do you remember? He says, what Moshe spoke, again, concerning me and you at Kadesh Barnea, the place of the sin of the spies. Ben arba'im shana nochi b'sholach Moshe ever Hashem otim Kadesh Barnea l'ragel et aretz. V'yishev oto davar kasherim levavi. And I responded with my heart. V'achai asher alui mi, but all my brothers who were with me, him sivit leva'am. V'anochi mi leiti acharei Hashem elokai. But I... Again, I followed Hashem fully, and that's why Moshe swore on this day that the land, Vayishava Moshe Vayimahu Leimor, Im lo ha'aret asher dakar raglachaba, lachati al nechalo banachad olam, kim leiti acharei Hashem alokai, vata hinei hachya Hashem oti kasher diber ze, 45 shana, mi'az diber Hashem et hadavar hazeh al Moshe, asher alach Yisrael b'midbar, vata hinei anechei yom, ben 5-80 shana, and therefore I want that land, i.e. Hebron. Notice that when Kalev speaks about what he did, he says, again, I was the one who spoke against all my brothers. Now, wait, Yoshua was also there, right? So in Kalev's words, there's no mention of Yoshua's role. And it's almost as if we only had Sefer Yoshua, then we would say that, yeah, I guess Kalev alone stood against all the other spies. And this is, to a certain degree, the way that Moshe is presenting it also in Parshat Devarim. And maybe if we leave out certain sections of Bamidbar, again, it seems this as well. So this is very interesting, because even if we say that, again, the whole idea of Kalev and Sefer Yoshua is to focus on him, but still, again, the fact that there's no mention at all of Yoshua while he's speaking to Yoshua is a little interesting, if not, I would say, again, very exaggerated. I'm the only one, right? Was he really the only one? So let's take a look and try to finally understand all these interesting omissions of Yehoshua ben Nun.
Doesn't it go back to before the Meraglim, when Moshe decided to change Yehoshua's name?
He's the beautiful.
He's the only one who he changed his name. He didn't change Kalev's name. Kalev went by himself to daven in Hebron. So there's a difference from the beginning between Moshe's Hityachasut to Yehoshua.
Beautiful, beautiful. So Sarah is 100% right, that we see that there's more of an embedded sense, right, of Kalev, that Kalev is the initiator. Again, still, even if Moshe was the one to give strength to Yehoshua, we would still expect then some etiachasut to the fact that Yehoshua also stood against the spies. Again, but Sarah's right. What we're going to start by doing is noting how really Yehoshua and Kalev represent two very different prototypes of leadership, which will also explain Yehoshua's behavior. Everyone ready for this? So now what we're going to do is to look carefully in the psukim that we already learned together. And this is what's going to help us even not only appreciate just the psukim and the questions, but even some of the midrashim that Sarah and Becky noted. So let's just remember, Yehoshua doesn't just merit in the end to enter Eretz Yisrael, but he ends up being the leader. And that's exactly the point. Yehoshua in Sefer Devarim is presented as having the zchut to enter the land because he's Moshe's faithful servant, because he's ultimately Moshe's successor of the leader of the nation. In other words, and this is what Sarah the Midrash is saying when it says that Moshe changed Hoshea ben Nun's name to Yehoshua. Again, the Midrash is saying that Yehoshua's strength comes from Moshe. In other words, Yehoshua's authority comes from Moshe. His manner, his personality are products, basically, of Yehoshua's devoted service to Moshe. And therefore, we can't expect Yehoshua to initiate or head anything independently. We shouldn't even expect of Yehoshua to say, Alo na'ale, again, while Moshe is still in the picture. Because, again, this is what Chazal say, that a Talmud is not allowed, again, to be Moreh Halacha in front of his Rav. That's right. Again, so for this reason, imagine this. Again, try to picture the scene. The Meraglim are there. They're talking about all the difficulties of a war against the nations. And Yehoshua, just as we said, is expecting even Kalev. They're both expecting Moshe to respond. And therefore, Kalev is going to try to silence the people so that Moshe can respond. Yehoshua isn't going to do anything because he's expecting Moshe to respond. Moshe is the leader. Moshe is his master. Moshe is his teacher. And therefore, he's going to remain silent, even though, of course, he's angered by the words of the other Meraglim. And that's what's going to come across the next time. Kalev, on the other hand, is not dependent on Moshe, right? That medrasara of Kalev going to Marat HaMachpelah, that is really based on Sefer Yehoshua and Sefer Dvarim, right? The place that only he went, because Vayavo Chavron is only in singular. Kalev is independent, right? Kalev acts on his own. Kalev responds in a matter of someone who has his own opinion, right? Lo na'ale. He basically says, again, wait a second, I disagree. You know what? You know, putting Moshe aside, I was there, and I think it's only when Moshe and Aaron fall on their faces that Yehoshua understands that Moshe, again, under that Moshe now is reacting in a severe way, right? That basically, almost out of a desire to protect Moshe Rabbeinu from being stoned, does Yehoshua voice his support now for Kalev's opinion? So Kalev is really the first one. Kalev features, again, as an independent leader, right? He has faith in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in the nation of Israel, in the land of Israel. Again, Ki Achon Nuchala. Yehoshua, Yehoshua's leadership, or Yehoshua himself, isn't a leader by his own merits, right? He is a leader because of Moshe Rabbeinu. The fact that he's Moshe's loyal servant is the source of his greatness, is the source of his power. Again, and at the same time, you ready for this? It's also the source of his weakness. His actions, again, I don't really know here in the story of Parsha Shlach. I don't really know what he believes. Again, all I know is that Gandhi is reflecting loyalty, not necessarily independent leadership.
Sonny, he's also an extension of Moshe.
That's exactly it.
His word would not be taken very well. Kalev is independent. He's also objective. Yehoshua is very subjective. And also, if we go back to Baha'u'llah and Eidan and Medan, when they were prophesizing according to
this past week's parsha, beautiful.
Was Yehoshua beautiful. Was going to become the leader. So
very nice. Oh, we don't know that yet. We don't know that yet. So that's important. So we're going to refer back to that. I'm very happy that Becky's mentioning this. So Yefem Od. So let's even try to understand why Moshe Rabbeinu in Parsha Devarim, again, really explains what happens. Again, there he says that Yehoshua merits to enter the land because he's Moshe's loyal servant and eventually also his successor. Again, and not because he stood against the Meraglim, not because he joined Kalev. This is because when Yehoshua did speak, it wasn't out of being against the Meraglim. It was more standing by Moshe, right? Rather than adopting an independent stand of a leader, again, it was really only Kalev who displayed a Ruach Acheret. Yehoshua was just continuing the Ruach of Moshe. So we find, just as Becky said, this isn't the first time that Yehoshua is going to appear more in Moshe's shadow, right? Where else do we see this? Even before, can everyone help me out? And let's see the perpetuation, the idea of the development of Dmuyot in Tanakh. Even before Parshat Baalotra, where do we see this? We're going to get to Eldad Umeida. Don't worry, Becky. But where else do we see this? Amalek, very nice. You see an Amalek. Again, Yehoshua became the leader because Moshe commanded him to, right? Moshe says to Yehoshua, you choose the men, you go to war against Amalek. Again, but the actual description makes it very clear that the success even of Yehoshua on the battlefield is not because of Yehoshua's Ruach HaCheretz. It's not because of Yehoshua's, strong military might, but rather because Moshe's arms are going to be lifted. Again, Yehoshua is victorious only because of Moshe, because Yidei Moshe are going to be risen up so that everyone turns their heads klapei mala. That's number one. The second time that we find Yehoshua is in Parshat Ki Tisa, how we're describing, again, in the context of Chayta Egel, how Yehoshua sat by Moshe's tent. And it says, Velo Yamush, he didn't leave. Again, Moshe Rabbeinu's tent. So even when Moshe leaves his tent to speak to Hashem, Yehoshua doesn't leave. So again, Yehoshua is this loyal servant. And Becky mentioned, what do you mean? We just heard about this, Parshat Baalotran, the story of Eldad Umeidad. Remember, Yehoshua sees that, wait a second, there are going to be Nevi'im, Hamid Nevi'im, but Machaneh, there are people who are receiving Nevuah without Moshe even appointing them. And what does he turn to Moshe and say? Adoni Moshe Kla'im, Moshe, you have to lock them up, you have to incarcerate them. These are rebellious prophets that are, I don't know, impersonating Moshe Rabbeinu. You have to imprison them. And Yehoshua, obviously, again, is standing up to defend Moshe Rabbeinu. And Moshe Rabbeinu says, Halavai, right? Mi Tena, Kol Am Nevi'im. Why are you so zealous for me? I wish that everyone would serve as Nevi'im. So we see from here that Yehoshua is very zealous for his master Moshe.
Sonny, do we realize that the only person who saw the Aseret HaDibrot was Yehoshua?
Yeah, fair. Oh, wait, who saw the Aseret? You mean who saw the original?
He was the original Luchos. He was the one that was standing below waiting for Moshe to come. And before he broke the Luchot, even Aaron HaKohen didn't see them. But Yehoshua
saw the Luchot. Yeah,
so he must have been the one that saw the Luchot. And he's the only
He's the only one other than Moshe who saw the original Luchot. Yefeh ma'od. So keep in mind, though, Yehoshua sees the luchot in the hands of Moshe.
Right.
Moshe was given these luchot by Hashem, right? So same idea by that whole scene of Chayta Egel. That's an excellent point, that Yehoshua is a kana'i for Moshe, whereas Moshe is a kana'i for Hashem, right? And that's why, by the way, in the Eldad Omeidat story, that's why he views Nevuah as something so positive, because, oh, it's for HaKadosh Baruch Hu, whereas Yehoshua sees Nevuah stemming from Moshe. So here, there are contestants to that Nevuah. Now also, even let's look at the beginning of Parshat Shlach. At the beginning, just as Sarah and me mentioned, we see a list of all these Anashim Chashuvim, as Rashi says, right? These princes, these Nesiim who are selected to go and spy the land, right? The very beginning of Perek Yud Gimel, if you look. And at the end of the list, we see that Moshe calls Hoshea ben Nun Yehoshua. And again, the even in Pshat, this is a very interesting pasuk, right? Meaning, what's the significance of changing his name? And why does the Torah mention it specifically here? After all, he was called Yehoshua also by Muhammad Amalek in Parshat B'Shalach. So why is it mentioned here? And it seems that this is the basis of the Midrash, that this is exactly what we've been speaking about with regard to Yehoshua. A person's name basically is an expression of his essence. And the fact that Moshe names Hoshea Yehoshua means that he instills Yehoshua with his essence, right? He influences him. So this is almost like a little bit of a hint of what's going on in the continuation of the story. Yehoshua is destined to stand up to the other spies because he's inspired by Moshe. He's Moshe's misharet. He's Moshe's servant. And therefore, regardless of any other opinion he may have, he has to stand up in defense of Moshe. Also, we know that later in Bamidbar Perach of Zion, okay, so if you want, you can flip, but you don't have to. Gena, there, I'll just let you know that Yehoshua's leadership is going to commence with Moshe Rabbeinu putting his hands on Yehoshua, the first smicha that we find in all of Jewish history. And in the Sefer Devarim also, it says that Moshe Rabbeinu is told, right? Okay, Yehoshua will also enter the land because Yehoshua stands before you, right? This idea also, again, tells us Yehoshua is Moshe's successor, Moshe's replacement. Again, Yehoshua's leadership becomes a continuation of Moshe Rabbeinu. And that's really not just the source of his argument, that's the source of his strength. So notice that also when we open up Sefer Yehoshua, Hashem even says, chazak v'mat, because your leadership is a continuation of that of Moshe Rabbeinu. Even when, if you remember, when Yehoshua is looking upon Pnei Yericho, wondering how in the world is he going to conquer Yericho, there's the revelation of a malach. Do you remember this? There's a sar tzava, right? And this is also very parallel. Again, the malach says, shal nacha mi'al raglecha, the exact same words of Moshe by the sne, and the miraculous expression of Hashem helping Yehoshua crossing the Yarden, having the Yarden dry, just like Hashem did for Moshe over and over again. This motif echoes, whether it's the Yarden and Kriyat Yamsuf, or again, the idea of the man stopping, and it started during a time of Moshe. Again, the Brit of Shechem that Moshe talks about in Parshat Ki Tavo, all this are basically, again, serving to literally continue the dmut of Moshe Rabbeinu. So Yehoshua is almost, I would even argue, what a beautiful way for us to end our series of Shirim, because Yehoshua really is that primary example of how the Torah says it's important, actually, to see the perpetuation of certain personalities in every generation, exactly the way that we began, and to realize that there are successors. And therefore, again, the purpose of Moshe's mission was, as we know, to bring Am Yisrael to Eretz Yisrael. And Moshe, unfortunately, is prevented from fulfilling his mission, right? And therefore, the last remaining stages aren't subject to, again, to, I would say, even if he can't be the one to do this, in the end, it's still going to be his leadership that does this. In other words, it's still going to be, again, his successor. Basically, Yehoshua is going to be the one to continue his form of leadership. He succeeds Moshe. Again, the whole idea of showing that Moshe's mission was completed by a pseudo-Moshe personality, by Yehoshua, who follows Moshe's path. He's chosen to complete Moshe's mission. He, in the end, is seen as like the mini Moshe, bringing us into Eretz Yisrael. And that's why we know the Chazal compare Moshe Rabbeinu to the Chama, to the sun, and Yehoshua's light to the Lebanah, the moon. That's right, which is basically, you know, the illumination of the moon is a clear reflection of the light of the sun. So again, this is in Bhava Batra. And the moon will continue to give off the light that is received from the sun, even when the sun's not really there, right? Even when the sun's not around. So Moshe's mission not only will be completed, but actually will continue, as opposed to Kalev. Kalev's reaction was, one can argue, was definitely preferable to that of Yehoshua, and that Kalev displays his own independent leadership. But it's exactly for this reason that he can't replace Moshe. Because one who doesn't need Moshe in order to respond, Kalev has his own independent leadership. And he himself displays leadership, so he can't be the replacement for Moshe, right? He's too much his own person. So from a different perspective, he's worthy of all the rewards that are mentioned time and time again. He's worthy, again, for being so courageous, for his absolute opposition to the Meraglim, a reward that, if you think about it, Yehoshua isn't worthy of, because Yehoshua wasn't standing up on his own. And this is the reason, really, for their separation in these two different parashiyot. Kalev's reaction expresses his desire to go back, to go to the land, again, where his feet had gone, his confidence in the nation of Am Yisrael, in, again, who he sees as representing. So his reward is going to be, yeah, you're going to go into the land. You're going to also be able to give this land as a Yerusha to your descendants. Again, and based on this, it should only be Kalev, but Yehoshua, again, not only was he not party to the incitement of the Meraglim, and not only, again, clearly he didn't betray his mission, nonetheless, again, and therefore he and Kalev are also going to be mentioned together, even though he wasn't really as independent as Kalev. So Kalev and Yehoshua basically are going to serve as both continuing, again, the spirit of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And these are really reflective of two different positions now. And that's why we said it's not just about Kalev and Yehoshua, but their personalities, that they're going to be perpetuated in different generations, because these are two positions of bitachon in Hashem, right? And we see this here, again, with regard to how they each responded. Let's look again at Perek Gimel, Pasuk Lamed, when Kalev, Vayas Kalev etam lefnei Moshe. What does he say? Alo na'alek yachonu chala. Yehoshua and Kalev say together, not alo na'alek, but they talk about don't rebel against Hashem. Gena Hashem, Gena is going to get rid of all these other nations. Notice a Kalev speech is very short. And all he's talking about is that, again, okay, that's it. We're going to go into the land, no problem, no need for any external justification, no need to say anything other than yachonu chala, we're going to prevail. He's saying, okay, stop being skeptical and stop being fearful, and let's just, like, you know, my grandfather would always say in Yiddish, for weiter, you know, just continue on. And that's exactly it. Like, no metaphors, you know, no fancy words. Again, as opposed to, what's interesting is that when he speaks together with Yehoshua, then again, they talk about bitachon b'Hashem, Yeshua Hashem. Again, Hashem is with us. Don't fear them. Again, and Yehoshua, basically, when Yehoshua speaks, he's not telling the nation that it's their strength, right? That's what I was saying before. Kiachonu chala. Kalev says, yeah, I don't know exactly how. It doesn't make a difference. God, us, we're going to be successful. Yehoshua is the one to say, no, it's because HaKadosh Baruch Hu is with us. It's not the nation's strength that's going to determine what happens. Rather, it's their faith in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And what's so interesting is that it's Yehoshua who basically, again, projects everything back to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, which is more the continuation of the leadership style of Moshe Rabbeinu, right, who says over and over again, you know, Hetziatzvu ruat Yeshuat Hashem, you stand, Hashem is going to save you. Hashem yelachim lachem v'atem tachem rishon, right? Hashem is going to battle for you. So Moshe, again, understands that, yes, the successes that we have are completely dependent on Siyata Dishmaya, completely dependent on Hashem's assistance.
And it's, Johnny, there's also something else. Kalev ben Yefuneh Shevet Yehuda. When he says Alona Ale, he's talking as a Shevet. He's talking as the monarchy, the Malchut.
Very nice. Very nice.
Yeshua as Ephraim.
Beautiful. Beautiful. And there's a lot to say. They're both Mashiach ben Yosef, Mashiach
Nahon,
ben
David.
Yafeh. So again, Mashiach ben David is a leader in his own right. Mashiach ben Yosef is more the continuation. Yafeh ma'od. So notice then that that's why when Moshe Rabbeinu talks about the Meraglim, at the beginning of Sefer Devarim, he himself says, he says, I told you, don't be afraid because Hashem will help you. Again, in other words, why does he say, I told you? Because Yoshua said it. And that was basically, you know, he learned that from me. Again, these ideas of bitachon, of emunah, again, the whole idea of Chet HaMeraglim was that they didn't have enough emunah b'Hashem. So Moshe talks about, yes, I can't believe you don't remember all those nisim and niflaot that Hashem had done. Whereas Kalev, again, it's not that Kalev doesn't have emunah b'Hashem, but the whole idea is that Kalev, again, has trust that, okay, you know, there's a emunah, almost an emunah tmima. So the message here is that Kalev doesn't necessarily, again, have to go into a whole discussion of, you know, shame on you, you don't have emunah, because he believes simply that if Hashem sent us to enter Eretz Yisrael, then we're capable of doing this. Again, and not only through external help, right? He says, alo na'alek yachon nuchala, we can do this. We don't need miracles. Again, his faith is very imminent, right? He basically speaks about, well, if we're here and Hashem has chosen us and he sent us, then obviously we have the power. So Kalev has faith in the inherent power. Like Sarah says, it's not a bad thing. He has faith in the power of Am Yisrael, rather than say that I have faith only in God's power to save them from the enemies. He says, Ki achon nuchala, we'll be able to prevail. Again, we have this inside of ourselves, right? We don't need miracles. Whereas Yehoshua, like Moshe, to say, again, I can't believe this. I can't believe you don't believe in the miracles of Hashem. So now let's talk about the future, right? For the future, this is why Yehoshua has to be the successor for Moshe Rabbeinu, because the whole idea is to make sure that the foundation of faith really is not in us, but in Hashem, and really is in the Yeshua of Hashem. So at the first stage of entering into the land has to be Yehoshua. Again, the continuation of Moshe's leadership in the wilderness. But again, what's interesting is that there's no, after Yehoshua, we know there's no continuation of Yehoshua's leadership, which is why the Midrash talks about how, you know, what Yehoshua, at the end of his life, he doesn't talk about who's going to perpetuate him. Because again, you know, Chazal say, we're his sons, we're his daughters. And Chazal say he didn't have sons, he didn't have daughters. And again, the idea of a Yehoshua who tries, as we, you know, as we've seen, he's not heard at the initial stage. And Chazal even say that, yeah, Yehoshua tried to speak when Kalev spoke and no one wanted to listen to him because he's viewed as a continuation of Moshe Rabbeinu. And according to Chazal, it's actually Kalev who helps him, right? So what's the difference between them? Again, where is this idea of, again, of Yehoshua not necessarily having this, again, the strength of character, but really coming from Moshe Rabbeinu? And I think that the basic ideas here are obviously the prototypes of leadership that really do continue. And just as Becky was alluding to, these are really representatives of Yehuda and Yosef, that these are two prototypes of leadership, Kalev and Yehoshua, that one can argue really perpetuates the personalities of Yosef, again, and Ephraim, versus Kalev from Yehuda, because we've always seen that the leadership of Ephraim and Yosef, again, firstly precedes that of David, of Yehuda, whether it's, again, Mashiach ben Yosef, who's going to come before Mashiach ben David, Yehoshua, who comes before David HaMelech, again, and the profound connection between these types of leaderships, and the idea of trusting in Hashem, that's Yosef, versus also having the power to know that we can overcome on our own. Again, that's a quality of Malchut Yehuda, which is very, very significant. And I think that if you look at these two personalities, you see that we have them in every generation. The ones that firstly turn us to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and then after that, and the whole idea is really after that, to be able to say, wait a second, again, we have we're living such a clear religious life. Again, in religious life, we have to understand that, of course, we need Yehoshua, we need Yosef, we need Ephraim, we need this initial foundation of faith in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. But really, what the story is telling us is only for a limited time, because the higher level of Emunah is one where we find the power of HaKadosh Baruch Hu really within ourselves, within our reality. Again, if a person, right, will
that's
only
what
believe.
You see, David HaMelech.
Beautiful, beautiful. That's exactly it. Again, we're supposed to be not just, you know, recognizing that, okay, Hashem has all the strength. We're supposed to recognize that Hashem natan lanu koach lasot chayom. And that's why, again, this is really, I would say, not the perfect conclusion. We can never really end our series, but understanding that personalities are meant to help us in every generation, right? And definitely personalities of leadership to help us realize, wait a second, these really do continue in every generation and they're not static, right? Rather, these are dynamic personalities. The fact that there are so many analogies that we've been discussing this entire year, again, that helps us be a little more sensitive to the leadership that we see, again, around us, and perhaps is supposed to motivate us to strive even amongst ourselves, to make sure that it doesn't just stay, you know, current, but that we make sure that the leadership and the messages continue, and not just continue in the status quo, but continue, again, to be enhanced, continue to develop in a very positive way in every generation. So I want to thank you really for motivating me week after week in exploring the perpetuation of these personalities by Yamei Mahim Bazman Hazeh, to explore both Tanakh and Talmud and appreciate the different perspectives of Midrash and really enlighten, again, my life. And I hope that this has also inspired you.
Thank you.
So have a wonderful, uplifting summer, Bez. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you
so much.
See, Mazel Tov. Mazel Tov. I didn't get to shul, but Yadena was there. Etty had a bar.
Oh,
Mazel Tov. Mazel Tov, Etty. Beautiful. Thank beautiful.
You. Yeah.
And her grandson did, not her.